Welcome to Flash Gordon, the official story of the film podcast. This series will look behind the scenes of the forthcoming book that celebrates the making of the movie from 1980. I'm filmmaker and author John Walsh, and I will take you on a journey through time and space to discover how Flash Gordon has become one of the most iconic science fiction films in the last 40 years. I will be speaking with the cast and the crew and fans of the film and giving you an insight into the making of the book. As we lead up to the publication date, I will reveal details of forthcoming events, and there'll be a chance to win copies of the book too. This could be a bumpy ride, so for God's sake, strap yourselves down! Hello and welcome to this very special episode of Flash Gordon, the official story of the film video podcast. I've got somebody here who worked with me on the book and contributed some images that have never been seen before and wouldn't have been seen if it wasn't for this man, Tim Laws from Prop Store. Hello, Tim.
Hey, John, how you doing?
I'm very well, thanks. And can you tell me a bit about Prop Store to start with?
Yeah, sure. Prop Store has been trading for about 20 years now. We sell props and costumes as memorabilia. We recently moved into selling those items on by auction as well, which has been very successful. The company was founded by Stephen Lane in 1998. And, you know, we're all collectors at heart. So we love this stuff. We love tracking it down and we love selling it and finding new homes for it. We're all just temporary custodians of this stuff. So it's important to keep it, keep the community moving and building excitement. And, we see from this auction catalog that we've got 900 items in this auction in all price ranges. And it's an incredible collection. It really is.
Prop Store is like the collector's place. And they collected you, didn't they? Because you were one of the first people to work for Prop Store. My research tells me, is that right?
I was the first. Year 2000, I think, I started working with Stephen, and it was just the two of us working from his front room, walking down to the post office every day, sending photographs out, because not everybody had internet back then either. But it was, it seems like a long time ago. Now we have two offices, one in Los Angeles, one here in London, about 50 employees, I think, all told. It's crazy, but we all love it. We're all film fans.
That's fantastic. Now, when I was writing this book, Flash Gordon, the official story of the film, I contacted you because we'd worked together on a previous book, Harryhausen Lost Movies, because I'm a trustee of the Ray Harryhausen Foundation. And of course, Ray's made such wonderful films throughout the years that stuff comes across your desk regularly and we help you try to sort of authenticate things. And I suppose authentication is a big part of the job, isn't it? The provenance, as it's sometimes called.
Yeah, it is. And that process does vary from item to item. Sometimes when it's come directly from maybe the actor that used it, which does happen, we still check it out. We still make sure it matches, because there's no telling what happens on a set. The actor could receive something from the prop man. So there you are, take it home. But that might be an unused spare, or it might be a prototype. We still check it out no matter who it's come from. And that process is a very big part of what we do.
Now, behind you, I can see some wonderful stuff from the Star Wars universe. And of course, you regularly read things in newspapers about, Star Wars robots and costumes and so on, but less so about Flash Gordon. And when I started researching the book, I found that there was very little out there in terms of even photographs for the book. So it was a real kind of detective job we started. But your team at Prop Store had some amazing high resolution photography of what turned out to be the largest collection of Flash Gordon props and pieces of memorabilia that we could find anywhere. So you're effectively the number one Flash Gordon props company. And you've got some amazing stuff, exclusive stuff laid out in front of you there today, Tim. What can you tell me about that?
So obviously with Flash Gordon being filmed in the UK, a lot of the crew guys are still around who worked on that film. Props and costumes had little or no value back then when Flash Gordon was around. So people took them home. It was probably going to end up in the skip. So people took props home, they took costume pieces home for whatever reason. And for the majority, most part, they kept it. And now this stuff has a value. Flash Gordon, as you know better than anyone, has an incredible cult following. It seems to be more popular now than it's ever been. And, you know, this stuff still comes along. And the pieces that I have in front of me have come, not all of them, but the majority from one collector. And the condition of them is what's really special about these. I mean, I don't know how well you can see them there, but the normally with these fiberglass props, the paint flakes off them. And most of the ones we've seen in the past have been in the condition varies a little bit, but it can be poor. These are probably some of the best I've ever seen. You know, this long after the film, these have been really well looked after.
Now, it's interesting you say about the value of props, because, of course, Flash Gordon was not considered to be a successful film when it was first shown in cinemas back in 1980. Did very well in Europe and in the East, but not so well in America. So Dino De Laurentiis' plans to make three Flash Gordons back to back was shelved. So for a great many years, the pieces of memorabilia, the props, the costumes and the storyboards really had sort of fan interest, but they weren't of commercial value for those first couple of decades. When would you say the sort of the needle started to go up in terms of value for Flash Gordon?
I think it's the story of Flash Gordon is probably the same with most films, in that the people buying this stuff now are the people that were kids when that film was out. And those guys and girls have money in their pockets now. And a lot of what we do is nostalgia. A lot of what we do is recapturing childhood. And I think that's a huge part of it. So the guys now that are sort of maybe 50 something, they've, you know, may have a few pounds spare in their wallet. And this is a major part of their childhood. And this is a big part of what we do.
So it's a big step up from if you wanted to buy a rare Star Wars figure. And I'm quite a boy fan of that. I remember when the Star Wars figures came out and pestering my parents to get me the Millennium Falcon and all of the other attachments and various toys. But this is almost like the Rolex of collecting, isn't it, for fans of Star Wars?
Yeah, you're talking about the same things, the same principle there. It's just that Star Wars has a bigger, wider following, and therefore there's more demand for a similar number of pieces, to be fair. But with Flash Gordon, it's a movie from that exact same time period. You're talking about exactly the same customer, but maybe a slightly different taste.
Now, it's interesting because Danilo Donato, who was the production designer and costume designer on the film, came up with much of these designs. And they are very different, aren't they, Tim? You wouldn't mistake these as being from other sci-fi films of the time. You wouldn't think, oh, it could be from Saturn III or from, Star Trek, the motion picture. They have a very distinctive look. So when something comes on your desk, do you think that's definitely Flash Gordon?
Yeah, and the costumes as well. The whole look and style of the film is unique, I think. I'm not sure I can think of anything that gets close. Maybe Barbarella back in the day was a similar kind of feel to it. But yeah, you're right. When you get a something arrive from Flash Gordon, it's pretty unmistakable.
And interestingly, Barbarella was from the same producer, Dino De Laurentiis, with the fabulous Jane Fonda being a sort of a voluptuous space girl, wasn't she, in that? And some of the same technologies with the flying
hawk. I remember.
Well, I don't remember it from the time, but I've kind of seen it since. So you've got some pretty significant pieces there. You've got the masks and some hero, what are sometimes referred to as hero pieces. And hero pieces are the ones that featured on camera?
Yes. So, well, we've got a selection of everything here. The Hawkman gun to my right here is interesting. It's a special effects piece. So I'm not sure, we don't have a very good zoom facility on this particular camera, but this has a toggle switch on the underside, and also a PowerPoint on this side here, which would have allowed for the barrel to flicker with a strobe light. The bulb, there's evidence of the bulb still there, but I've never seen a special effects Hawkman gun in the 20 or 30 years that, well, I've been collecting for 30 years, been here at Prop Store for 20, and this is the first one of these I've ever seen.
Hero's hit! I'm going in after him!
Impetuous boy!
Oh, well, who wants to live forever?
And the same for the Ming gun here as well. It's a very similar setup. We've got a PowerPoint on this side, and a trigger mechanism on the underside there. The piece, the bulb is all missing from the front, but all the attachments are there. But because of the way these were constructed, just kind of solid fiberglass units, there's no way of getting back into them now and kind of powering them up again. But with the condition of this and the fact that it's a special effects gun, really makes it an exciting piece.
And as you say, because it's a one-off film, there's very much, there's a cap, isn't there, on the amount of props and pieces and models that would be available from this singular film.
That's true. And the other thing with this fiberglass, because it chips and flakes so easily, the condition of them is generally, for the ones we've seen in the past, is very, very poor. And I know I've seen broken ones and smashed ones, and those probably don't survive. You know, a lot of them would have not survived filming. And then the ones that have gone into the collector's market are, you know, it is a finite number, and I would say it's diminishing.
So when people come and knock on the door and say, I'm looking for certain pieces in terms of wish list, what would you say for Flash Gordon? If you could go back in a Doctor Who's TARDIS and go on the set and have a rifle through when they strike the set, is it the models? Is it the Hawkmen wings? Is it Flash Gordon's T-shirt?
That's just what I was going to say. Flash Gordon's T-shirt, I think that is the signature piece of the film. A year or two ago, we did have the red leather jacket, which I thought was a really nice costume piece for Sam Jones. But I think if anybody could have a single item, it'd probably be that T-shirt.
Originally, the production designer wanted to do a Diamondique version of it. So Flash was going to be wearing an entirely Diamondique style vest and leather hot pants. And director Mike Hodges says, nah, that's not happening. You know, this film is as outrageous already as it is.
I think that's probably a good decision. Yeah, good decision.
Now, I'm always very interested in the spaceships from the film, and the design of those is really distinctive as well. Have you come across many of those in your travels?
No, we've had a very few model miniature pieces, but they are super scarce, and we've not handled any of those directly, I don't think. Not from my memory. My memory's not as good as it used to be, but I don't seem to recall those pieces are rare. I know of a few pieces in collections, but not ones we've handled.
Now, the film itself has got its own sort of reputation and legend around it. And Studio Canal, who we worked with to do this new book, have restored the film in 4K. And I was really hopeful that they might find some of the deleted scenes, because we have photographs of deleted scenes in the book that show what could have been and so on, for the ending, for a spider sequence with Dale, for the arrest of Princess Aura. So there's lots potentially still out there. How much do you hope that one day someone will come knocking on your door with a big box of stuff and say, look, I've inherited this house, we've done a clear out, this could be from Flash Gordon?
A good example of this last year was that we sold a Stormtrooper helmet in our auction. It went for almost 200,000. So it grabbed a few headlines. And then on the following Monday, the phone rang, and it was a lady saying that she'd had one of these Stormtrooper helmets that her mother had got at Elstree Studios. She was a cleaner there, and she'd had it in her cupboard for 40 years. And it's not a story I haven't heard before, but with all the publicity, I said, sure, please send me some photos, I'll take a look for you. And sure enough, she had a Star Wars helmet from A New Hope. And as well as it being a real cash in the attic find for her, and really exciting, as far as the Star Wars community goes, it's a brand new item. It's a new Star Wars helmet into the marketplace that nobody knew even existed. And it was just sitting in this lady's cupboard for 40 years. Now, she knew what it was, but it was only after our auction she realized the value. And that kind of thing happens all the time. You know, the publicity we generate stimulates people to pick up the telephone or drop us an email, and you really never know what you're going to get. And this stuff came out of the blue. This is a guy who's had the majority of this stuff for a long time, and has now decided, you know, as I said, we're all temporary custodians. He's decided now's the time to let another collector enjoy them. And like I say, that's the most exciting part of what we do, I think.
It is close to confession, Your Majesty. Should we stop the torture?
No.
Father! Damn you, father!
Now, there at the front, that looks like a Clytus mask that Peter Wingard would have worn as Clytus in the film, is that right?
Yeah, it's interesting you mentioned the deleted scenes, because that Clytus mask was originally attached to a skull, and it's a deleted scene where they travel... you'll know better than me, because it's a deleted scene, but apparently they go back to a home planet, and there's these skulls and these masks are dotted around as part of the set. So the style is the same as the Peter Wingard mask. It's lost its colour, but not worn by Peter Wingard, but it's really, really nice. It's a great reference.
Yeah, we have it in the book, and it's at the end of the film, as we know, it's where the wedding is crashed by Flash and the Hawkmen. That wasn't the original ending for the film. That was the start of a big fight that involved Miming the Merciless actually converting himself into other characters and other creatures. And there was this major confrontation with Flash and all of the Hawkmen and the Arborian tree men. But of course, there was no time to shoot that. There was plenty of money. This is the terrible irony on Flash Gordon. They had lots of money, but very little time. So Mike Hodges was pulling pages all of the time. And this sequence that you're talking about, Tim, with the skulls, it was filmed. So I know that much, and I have some photographs of it, but the footage has yet to be located. So it'd be very exciting to locate that footage in a future release of the film, I think.
See, I told you you'd know more about it than me.
Well, I've written the book, so if I didn't, I'd be in big trouble. They'd want to know how comes I don't know. So in terms of your own archive, because we've relied on you for this book and the Harryhausen book and another book, which I can't talk about yet, but that you're already helping me with, which I'm very grateful for. You've become an archive in yourself, really, because you're documenting these props in high-resolution photography, and the catalogues that you publish are actually collector's items as well, aren't they?
Yeah, that's part of... It's kind of a byproduct of what we do, but it is very important. We're well aware that some of these pieces will disappear into collections and private institutions and not be seen again. You know, everybody has their own reasons for purchasing these items. And it's very important that we maintain a record of what we've had, as well as for our own use to research. It's noting history as we go, as you say, for your book. It's a great reference, and we're happy to provide it.
Your catalogues sell out as well, don't they? There's a demand for previous catalogues.
Yes, the catalogues we wanted from day one for the catalogue to be almost a coffee table book. We wanted it to be a reference and an interesting guide. The descriptions we write and the photographs we take, it's all very important that, again, we're documenting history. And at the same time, it's an interesting thing that, you know, somebody might come around to your house, pick up the catalogue and start flicking through it, and you know, we may find a new interested person there, or we might just find somebody who just appreciates what we've done. And that's a big important thing of what we do.
Now, Christmas is just around the corner, of course, and the 40th anniversary of Flash Gordon is the 11th of December for the UK and the 8th of December for the US. So how much are all those kind of three dates in your mind when you're presenting new items such as these?
Well, because we moved to the auction platforms for the majority of the items, we're kind of guided date-wise by that. But there's definitely processes and thoughts that go into anniversaries, sequels, renewed interest. It is definitely a factor of how we play it. And 40 years, it doesn't seem like 40 years ago, does it? But that's certainly going to generate more interest, because there will be, like your book, you'll have anniversary editions, prints, the new 4K restoration. All of this goes into keeping that film alive and interest well and truly with us.
Now, when finally, Tim, can people get a chance to bid on some of these items?
Yeah, right now, actually, the catalogue went live today. So you can go online to propstore.com/live auction. All your information is there. You can bid online. You could register to have a phone bidder clerk with you on the day, so it's effectively being in the room. With these COVID times, we're not having any live bidders in the room, unfortunately, but the whole catalogue is there. 900 over 900 lots, 350 different TV and movie productions. All tastes are catered for as well. We've got items starting at a couple of £100s, going right up into six figures, so something there for everyone, I hope.
Stop at nothing.
Please drop me a line at auction@propstore.com if you have any questions. And I'm happy to talk about any of the pieces you see here, any pieces in the catalogue. If any of the Flash Gordon fans want to have a personal Zoom call and I can show people directly these items, happy to do that. Emails, no problems at all. And I think you'll enjoy this catalogue, because it's full of some really, really nice Flash Gordon items. And the catalogue is available to purchase online now as well too, as well as it being completely free and digital, a digital version as well.
I remember growing up, of course, with the Argos catalogue and a few other catalogues that my mum would have, and I'd always zoom straight to the toy page and try and sort of highlight what I want. And of course, what you've done is you've created like the ultimate catalogue, because I've looked at a recent one you had where you had some wonderful stuff from the original 1979 Alien, and I was like, oh yes, I'd like that, I'd like that, oh, I'd like that. And it's very exciting to page through and see what you could get.
Yeah, that is the downside, actually. Usually I find there's a little bit too much in there, and the credit card won't quite stretch to to everything we want. But it's a good reference. And like, as you said earlier, it's a really nice, makes for a really nice book in its own right.
Well, Tim, good luck with the auction, and may I wish you a happy Christmas, and there'll be a copy of Flash Gordon winging its way to you very soon.
Thank you, John. I really appreciate it.
Copyright in Flash Gordon, the official story of the film podcast, is owned by John Walsh and Titan Books Limited, under license from King Features Incorporated. Audio from the film is courtesy of Studio Canal. This recording may not be reproduced in whole or in part without written permission from us. The views expressed within these podcasts do not necessarily reflect those of the associated companies or its employees. For further terms and conditions, please contact us at our Facebook page, Flash Gordon, the official story of the film.